Members of the Board of Trustees, please respond present when you hear your name. Chairperson Thompson.
Present.
Trustee Arvanites. Thought I saw him. Okay. Trustee Berger. I did see you, Michael. I got you.
Yeah.
Trustee Berger.
Might have been on mute.
Trustee Berger, you're muted too. Got it. Okay. Trustee Clark is absent and excused. Trustee Cortez Vasquez.
Present.
Great. Trustee Ferrer.
Here.
Trustee Kim.
Present.
Great. Trustee Linares Garcia.
Present.
Great. Trustee Mojica. Okay, not yet. Trustee Oberfell. He's absent and excused. Sorry, that's my bad. Trustee Palacio.
Present.
Trustee O'Donnell Tormey.
Present.
Trustee Sunshine.
Present.
Trustee Vivolo.
Present.
Great. Trustee Wilkin.
Present.
And Trustee Burke.
Present.
Terrific. So we have no student trustee pending their election by the USS. They are still working on electing someone, but you have a quorum nonetheless. Did we lose Bill? There we go. You're muted, Bill.
Sorry about that.
Okay.
This public meeting of the City University of New York's Board of Trustees is now called to order.
Okay, so pursuant to the New York State Legislature's recent extension of the suspension of required in-person meetings under the open meetings law, this meeting is being held remotely via video conference with access to the public session available on the CUNY Board of Trustees website. A copy of the calendar and agenda of items is also available online at the CUNY Board of Trustees website. Additional items may be added during the meeting. As a reminder, please mute so we can ensure that everyone can hear. I will now take a roll call attendance for members of the Chancellery. Members of the Chancellery, please respond present when you hear your name. Chancellor Matos Rodriguez.
Here, here.
General Counsel and Senior Vice Chancellor for Legal Affairs, Derek Davis.
Present.
Executive Vice Chancellor and University Provost, Dan Lemons.
Present.
Executive Vice Chancellor and Chief Operating Officer, Hector Batista.
Present.
Senior Vice Chancellor for Institutional Affairs, Strategic Advancement and Special Counsel, Glenda Grace. Thought I saw Glenda's name pop up. But we'll have to double check that. Senior Vice Chancellor and Chief Financial Officer, Matt Sapienza.
Present.
Terrific. I think Glenda's trying to get in. There she is now. Senior Vice Chancellor for Labor Relations, Pamela Silverblatt.
Present.
Vice Chancellor and University Chief Information Officer, Brian Cohn.
Present.
Hey, Brian. Okay. Vice Chancellor for Communications and Marketing, Maite Yunko.
Present.
Terrific. Vice Chancellor for Risk, Audit, and Compliance, Richard White.
Present.
Okay. Interim Vice Chancellor, Vice Chancellor for Human Resources, Dorian Gloria.
Present.
Terrific. Interim Vice Chancellor for University Advancement, Andrea Shapiro Davis, may not be here for her last. And Interim Vice Chancellor for Student Affairs, Denise Maybank.
Present.
Okay, great. And Glenda, I will mark you present now.
Thank you.
No problem.
A couple of problems. Thank you.
Not a problem. Okay, so it's all you, Bill.
All right. Pursuant to the New York State Legislature's recent extension of the suspension of required in-person meetings under open meetings law, the Board of Trustees did not convene its January 24th, 2022 public hearing in person. Instead, the Office of the Secretary accepted written testimony, statements, and video from concerned individuals via email at hearings@cuny.edu. A total of 44 written and 21 video testimonies were submitted. Faculty and staff expressed concerns regarding the Omicron spike and are requesting that CUNY make the first 2 weeks of spring semester a transition period where most non-essential work and teaching is conducted remotely. Individuals also requested CUNY-wide distribution of respiratory personal protective equipment, either N95, KN95, or similar, more surveillance testing, and that CUNY share infection rates with faculty, staff, and students. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, or the entire Board of Trustees, I'd like to thank Governor Hochul for her commitment to quality public higher education in New York. The governor's recent executive budget proposal makes a major investment in CUNY and SUNY, $330 million, and enables us to continue our steadfast commitment to academic excellence while serving as a critical vehicle for the upward mobility of New Yorkers. The governor's budget calls for several important proposals which will have a direct impact on our students and faculty, including $62 million in increased tuition assistance for students and $53 million to hire 540 new full-time faculty, enhancing faculty-student mentoring while creating a critical career path for our adjunct faculty. The budget also includes important support to help our senior colleges provide financial aid to students whose federal and state tuition assistance does not fully cover their costs, also known as the TAP gap. Again, on behalf of the entire Board of Trustees, I'd like to thank Governor Hochul for recognizing the importance of CUNY to the overall economic vitality of our state. Trustees have been very busy since we last met. Trustee Lorraine Cortez Vasquez spoke at the Newmark Journalism School's December graduation, and nine trustees are currently involved with searches for the Dean at Macaulay Honors College, the J School, and the School of Professional Studies. Next month, trustees will also be actively participating in Middle States accreditation reviews at LaGuardia, CSI, and Hostos. Trustees have also been busy serving on Mayor Eric Adams' transition committees, with Trustee Sandra Wilkin serving as a member of the Economic and Workforce Development Transition Committee, and Trustee Cortez Vasquez serving as a member of both the Education and Public Safety and Justice Committees. And one of our board members, Kevin Kim, has joined the Adams administration as the commissioner of the New York City Department of Small Business Services. New York City is lucky to have such a talented mind tackling the issues facing small businesses as we continue our road to recovery. Congratulations, Kevin, my friend. Congratulations.
Hear, hear.
Let me now ask Chancellor Matos Rodriguez for comments. Chancellor?
Thank you, Chair Thompson. Let me just. And great to see the fellow trustees, presidents, and vice chancellors. Good afternoon and happy not so new anymore year to everyone. It's been a month and a half since our last meeting, and I hope that we all had the chance to enjoy the holidays and spend some downtime with family, despite the concerns created by the latest COVID-19 surge. Before I bring you up to date on our COVID-19 situation and other developments as we begin the spring semester, I would like to take a moment to express the university's sadness at the tragic loss of members of our community in recent weeks. NYPD officers Jason Rivera and Wilbert Mora were both members of the CUNY community, and their senseless death in the line of duty have been felt especially hard. Officer Mora was a 2018 graduate of the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, and Officer Rivera attended Lehman College and BMCC. They both joined the NYPD because they wanted to make a difference in their community's relationship with the police. They were heroic in their idealism, in their deeds, and in their sacrifice, and our prayers and thoughts go out to their families. Our university also was affected deeply by the horrible Bronx apartment fire earlier this month that claimed the lives of 17 people, including Sarah Jenneth, a sophomore at Lehman College. To her family, we offer sincere condolences, and our thoughts go out to the students and alumni from Hostos, BMCC, Bronx Community College, and Hunter College who reside in the building or have family members living there. Thank you for joining me in this moment of condolences and respect. I will now turn my report to the board. When we last met, Omicron was just beginning to take hold. The good news is that the surge is thankfully on the decline and is happening just in time for the beginning of the spring 2022 semester. With a number of proactive safety measures in place, we are poised to deliver the majority of our courses fully in person for the first time since the pandemic began nearly 2 years ago. We are proceeding with our plan to expand the return to campus life that we began in the fall. It's a goal that we believe is vital to our students' academic success and indeed to CUNY's continuing mission to be a transformative engine of social mobility. Together, we will continue to build on the successes of the 2021 year with a raft of exciting new programs and initiatives in the works and the prospect for a significant investment in CUNY by our state funding partners. The return to in-person instruction for the majority of our classes is made possible by a number of health measures. The requirement that students enroll in any in-person or hybrid class are vaccinated and boosted, an expanded and revamped testing strategy, and the continued use of masks. Although our campuses have some currently available, we have ordered more than 50,000 additional KN95 masks that our campuses will make available to their communities. Our most recent testing results show that the Omicron surge is tapering and our campuses are returning to lower rates of infection. We had our highest weekly infection rate from December 30th to January 5th, when 22.2% of our tests came back positive. The rates have declined each week since, and last week it was down to just 2.2%. The booster mandate policy announced by Governor Hochul for CUNY and SUNY is now in place. Under that policy, CUNY students who are eligible for a booster as of last Friday, January 28th, must upload proof of receiving that booster no later than March 1st. Those who become eligible after Friday will have 30 days after they become eligible to get their booster. Students who miss their deadlines won't be able to register for summer and fall classes until they upload their proof. For additional safety, the random testing of vaccinated students, faculty, and staff that began in late November is being expanded. We are doubling the number of people tested from 10% to 20% and increasing the frequency from once every 10 weeks to approximately once every 5 weeks. I want to thank everyone who is making the random testing program work, and that certainly includes the thousands of members of our community who have been selected and gone get tested as required. Their cooperation is vital to our efforts to get through the Omicron phase and the pandemic itself. All of the measures I've touched on are focused on the priority we've had throughout the pandemic, the safety of our students, faculty, and staff. We've been driven by the belief that we do best for our students when we're able to teach them in person and support them in campuses in person and to do so safely. And that's how we do best for the city too. I've said many times that New York City's road to recovery runs through CUNY. And it cannot be overstated how much our return to campus will bring back to life every neighborhood in New York City. Before I move on, let's take a moment to note the sheer resilience of our academic programs for these 2 years. While the pandemic has triggered a decline in our enrollment, as it has for universities nationwide, we have been resolute about minimizing the impact on our course offerings. Last spring, we were forced to eliminate hundreds of course sections, but this spring, we are bouncing back. We have 1,435 more sections than we had last spring, despite the pandemic-associated decline in enrollment. More offerings for our students. You're all aware, and our chair made reference to it, that we open the year with Governor Hochul's budget proposals signaling major investments in CUNY over the coming years. The governor's budget would enable us to make good on our plans to hire hundreds of full-time faculty members, among other initiatives that we have laid out, and I will provide and that will provide additional financial assistance to our full-time and part-time students. Since our board chair already congratulated and thanked the governor for that support, and since I'll be testifying about the budget next Monday in Albany, I will not go into any further detail here today. In another wonderful end of the year news for the university, a collaboration between CUNY and the New School was named one of four finalists in a competition to create a Center for Climate Solutions on Governor's Island. Our proposal is called the Climate Center Consortium, or C3. It will bring together a visionary group of institutions to merge the work of climate change adaptation and mitigation with environmental justice to develop leading a more sustainable future. The competition is administered by the city and the Trust for Governor's Island. I never tire of touting CUNY's record as a national leader in moving students into the middle class, and now we have two additional sources of validation. In December, the Social Mobility Index released its 2021 rankings, showing that we continue to lead the way nationally. Seven of our colleges were on the top ranks in providing an affordable education to students from low-income families and graduating them into well-paying careers. Baruch was named number one, and Brooklyn, Lehman, Hunter, Queens, John Jay, and City College were in the top 20. Last week, a report from public policy think tank Third Way found that 20 of our senior colleges were named among the top 50 colleges in the nation when it comes to providing the most economic mobility for students. And Lehman and John Jay were ranked among the country's 10 best. The report builds on the work of the economist Raj Chetty to create an economic mobility index. The CUNY School of Professional Studies was recognized again for the quality of its online programs by US News. SPS's online bachelor's degrees programs was ranked as the 10th best in the nation for the second year in a row. On Friday, the White House and the Justice Department recognized the CUNY School of Law among the law schools nationwide that answer Attorney General Garland's call to support those who have been affected by the grave pandemic's associated eviction crisis. Our law school's clinical programs, as you know, are widely regarded among the nation's best and most robust, so it comes as no surprise that the resources were already in place and much of the work already underway. Congratulations to the School of Public Health and Professor Bruce Lee on the announcement of an $8.1 million grant over 5 years from the NIH to be shared with West Point. They will launch a center, the first of its kind, that uses artificial intelligence and computational modeling to develop personalized nutrition and health guidance. We're excited to be part of this cutting-edge NIH initiative that will study diverse populations with goals that include bringing more equity to nutrition and health. John Jay has been awarded an important $2.6 million grant to help the city expand its Cure Violence program. This grant is a partnership with the Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice aimed at reducing gun violence, a problem whose urgency was sadly made all too clear this week with the terrible killing of the two police officers in Harlem that I paid tribute to earlier. John Jay's Research and Evaluation Center will study the effectiveness of the city's gun violence interruption programs over the next 4 years. I would like to take a moment to acknowledge Black History Month, which begins tomorrow, and present an opportunity to share that news that we expect to be announcing very soon about the exciting next steps in our Black Racial and Ethnic Studies initiative. As you know, in 2020, we received a historic $10 million gift from the Mellon Foundation that, among other things, supported the development of this new initiative to reimagine how we teach and study the racial and ethnic diversity that is so integral to CUNY and historic mission. I look forward to presenting the recommendations of the Initiatives Planning Commission to the board and the CUNY community in the very near future. I was also proud to participate in a meaningful and needed commemoration of the International Holocaust Remembrance Day last week with the Harriet and Kenneth Kofferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College. It came just after the recent hostage incident at a synagogue in Texas, another reminder of the persistence of anti-Semitism in our country. As I told the gathering, at CUNY, we stand united as a diverse community of many faiths, ethnicities, and races. We condemn hatred and work every day to make sure that every member of our community feels welcome, valued, and safe. I also have some good news and great stories to tell you about the generosity of our alumni with the strong bonds so many of them have to their alma maters. First, the trailblazing physicist Miriam Shirachik, who spent more than a half a century teaching and conducting groundbreaking research at CCNY, left a $1.5 million pledge to the college before her passing in October. It will establish the Miriam Shirachik Professorship Fund for a visiting physics professor at CCNY's Division of Science. More recently, the Times shared the quintessential CUNY story of Ciro Scala, who returned to City College nearly six decades after he dropped out and after retiring from a successful career. Scala earned two degrees, but did not stop there. He wanted to help students whose life stories parallel his own and set up a program at the Colin Powell School to help students who were the first in their families to go to college, and this at the young age of 80. I want to welcome Timothy Lynch, the interim president of the College of Staten Island, to his first Board of Trustees meeting since he began his second round as CSI's interim president. Also, as you know, we are saying goodbye to three valued and esteemed members of our senior administration, Brian Cohen, Andrea Shapiro Davis, and Matt Sapienza. Since we have board resolutions coming up later, acknowledging the great work that Brian and Andrea have done, I will leave my comments to say that they'll be missed and we wish them well in their journey. Matt Sapienza will be celebrating with a resolution later in our next board meeting. And we want to thank Matt for his service for 17 years to CUNY, and we wish him so much luck in his new role as CFO at ACLS. So let me join in thanking Andrea, Brian, and Matt for their service. And can I ask you for some virtual applause for the three of them? I join Chair Thompson also in congratulating Trustee Kim on being appointed as a new commissioner for New York City Department of Small Businesses. We look forward to even more partnerships with that department in the years ahead. That brings me to the end of my report. I trust that you share my excitement for the new semester and my cautious optimism for what I feel is going to be a period of renewal and growth for CUNY. I have high confidence in the steps we are taking to ensure the health and safety of our community while we bring back our campuses to a higher level of activity. As always, I thank you for your hard work and dedication to this great university. And that, Mr. Chair, concludes my report.
Thank you, Chancellor. Thank you so much. Let's now turn to the items requiring a vote today. Given that board members are participating remotely and we cannot see everyone on the screen at the same time, I'll read the resolutions and ask for members to respond only if you'd like to abstain or oppose an item. Otherwise, your vote will be recorded as a yes vote. If you are voting no or abstaining, please state your name and vote. Additionally, if you wish to second an item or have any questions, please state your name first for the record, and let's try to avoid speaking over each other. For clarity and coordination, I'll ask the secretary to read all of the items. Gail?
Okay, I'm going to take a moment of privilege. I just want to be sure, Robert, I will just want to acknowledge that you're present and I marked you in for voting. And My apologies, Vice Chancellor Mohammed Atala. I skipped over your name. So Mohammed Atala is also present. Okay, so item number one, approval of minutes of the regular board meeting and executive session of December 13, 2021, and the special board meeting of January 22, 2022.
May I have a second for that item?
Berger, second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number two is the Committee on Audit. Item 2A is a resolution requesting the approval of the university's fiscal year 2021 uniform guidance report, which was presented by our external audit firm, Grant Thornton LLP.
May I have a second for that item?
Tim, second.
Is there any discussion on the item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Number three is the Committee on Fiscal Affairs. Item 3A is a resolution to authorize a contract with CompuLink Technologies to provide help desk subscription services. Queens College is seeking approval to expand its help desk technology services from Freshworks, Inc., which was first implemented in March 2021 on a limited basis. The college has selected CompuLink Technologies, Inc., an MWBE value-added reseller at Freshworks, Inc., to purchase this software. Queens College is seeking a five-year contract with CompuLink Technologies for an amount not to exceed $54,400, tripping over my words.
Easy for you to say. May I have a second for that item?
Rare seconds.
Any discussion on the item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item 3B is a resolution to authorize a renewal purchase to maintain access to McAfee Corporation products and services. McAfee antivirus and computer protection products have been a core component of the university's cybersecurity tool set since 2011. The McAfee tools and related services help protect against ever-evolving malware and cybersecurity threats and include McAfee support resources dedicated to the university. The university is seeking approval to license McAfee products, services, and support through an authorized reseller for up to three annual renewals pursuant to a New York State Office of General Services contract, which shall not exceed a total of $2.5 million for three yearly renewals.
May I have a second for this item?
Rare seconds.
Any discussion on the item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 3C is a resolution to revise the university tuition and fee manual policy on withholding transcripts due to financial holds. The university's current policy is to withhold transcripts if a student has an unpaid tuition and fee balance. During the pandemic, this policy was temporarily suspended in order to assist students in their pursuit of furthering their education and or to seek employment. The university is requesting that this change be made permanent beginning with the spring 2022 semester.
May I have a second for this item?
Second.
As far as discussion on the item, one thing, let me again compliment the chancellor for recommending this strong move. It's a question of decency and fairness for our students. And I'd like to again commend you and your staff for bringing this forward. Thank you, Chancellor. Any discussion on this item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item number four is the Committee of Academic Policy Programs and Research Activities. And item 4A is a resolution regarding the establishment of a Bachelor of Science program in community health education at Megar Evers College. The COVID-19 pandemic has increased the need for community health educators to provide vital evidence-based health information, to diverse groups and communities. Megar Evers College's proposed Bachelor of Science in Community Health Education is designed to prepare students for multiple roles in the high-growth community health education field. The program will fulfill the college's goal to expand its healthcare in Central and South Brooklyn, match well-prepared career entrants with healthcare employment opportunities, and build the healthcare high school to career pipeline.
I have a second for this item.
Donald Cormie, second.
Any discussion on this item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item 4B is a resolution regarding the establishment of a bachelor's program in youth studies at the CUNY School of Professional Studies. SPS proposes a 120-credit online Bachelor of Arts degree in youth studies that will leverage the success of the school's Master of Arts degree and advanced certificate in youth studies. The program will be a collaboration with current students and alumni, as well as with partners at the New York City Department of Youth and Community Development and the Administration for Children's Services. The program is designed to hold both the intellectual curiosity about youth and the concrete skill development that is needed to work with the age group while infusing SPS's unique approach that is rooted in critical youth studies and an explicit commitment to social justice. Graduates of the youth studies program will be well-equipped to lead and serve in supervisory and managerial positions across city agencies and nonprofit organizations, and will also be prepared to embark upon graduate degrees in youth studies, social work, psychology, and education.
May I have a second for this item?
Donald Tormey, second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 4C is a resolution regarding the approval of the actions in the CAPRA dashboard. Routine academic matters, local academic policies, and course inclusions in the university's general education program are presented to the Committee on Academic Policy Programs and Research in summary form. Introduced in October 2019, the CAPRA dashboard makes it possible for trustees to interact with this summary data.
May I have a second for this item?
O'Donnell Tormey, second.
Any discussion on the item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 5 is the Committee on Faculty, Staff, and Administration. Item number 5A is a resolution to approve the Committee on Faculty, Staff, and Administration report. The December CFSA report contains actions entered into the CUNY system of record between October 16, 2021, and December 3rd, 2021. The report contains a total of 78 actions, including 39 appointments and reappointments with tenure, 12 fellowship leaves, and 15 ECP regular and interim appointments.
May I have a second for this item?
Second.
Is there any discussion on the item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved. Gail?
Item number 5B is a resolution to appoint Dr. Latoro Yates as Vice President of Student Development and Enrollment Management at Eugenio Maria de Hostos Community College at the City University of New York. Dr. Yates has served with distinction at the cabinet level at York College as the Executive Director for Enrollment and as the Interim Vice President for Enrollment Management and Student Affairs, where he achieved 3 consecutive years of reaching the highest enrollment, full-time equivalent and total headcount in the college's history, garnering approximately $90 million in tuition revenue. Dr. Yates holds a PhD in higher education leadership management and policy from Seton Hall University, an MA in business administration information systems from St. Peter's University, and a BS in accounting with a minor in business management from St. Peter's University. The president highly recommends this appointment from a search.
May I have a second for this item?
Second.
Any discussion on the item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 5C is a resolution to appoint Colette Atkins as Vice President for Institutional Advancement at Eugenio Maria de Hostos Community College at the City University of New York. For the past 9 years, Ms. Atkins has served with distinction as Associate Vice President for Development at the College of Mount St. Vincent, an Hispanic and minority-serving liberal arts college in New York City, where her achievements included helping the college surpass its campaign fundraising goal by $29 million to reach a comprehensive campaign total of $71 million. During her tenure at Mount St. Vincent, the number of donors giving at least $25,000 annually increased by 60%, and the annual fund rose from $800,000 to $2.1 million. Through Ms. Atkins' leadership, the College of Mount St. Vincent's Planned Giving Society membership rose from 100 to 300 individuals, and the college received millions of dollars in gifts and pledges, raising the college's endowment by 500%. Ms. Atkins holds an MA in Business Administration and Finance from the NYU Stern School of Business and a BA in History from the University of Michigan's Honors Program. The president highly recommends his appointment from a search.
May I have a second for this item?
Jim, second.
Second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item 5D is a resolution to appoint Evelyn A. Fernandez Ketchum as Vice President of Continuing Education and Workforce Development at Eugenio Maria de Hostos Community College at the City University of New York. For the past 8 years, Evelyn A. Fernandez Ketchum has served as Executive Director of Workforce Development in the Continuing Education and Workforce Development Division at Hostos Community College, where she has skillfully managed multiple grants, including the Health Profession Opportunity Grant, which is administered by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Administration for Children and Families. Through this grant, Hostos Community College receives approximately $2.1 million annually to provide education and training to temporary assistants and needy families, recipients, and other low-income individuals for occupations in the healthcare field. Ms. Fernandez Ketchum is a PhD candidate at the Yeshiva University Wurzweiler School of Social Work and holds an MS from the Columbia University School of Social Work and a BA in psychology from Marymount College. The president highly recommends this appointment from a search.
May I have a second for this item?
Second.
Is there any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Items 5E through 5H are resolutions to appoint distinguished professors effective February 1, 2022, with compensation of $28,594 per annum, in addition to their regular academic salary, subject to financial ability as follows. Dr. Mikkel Diekel is an internationally recognized scholar of comparative literature, 20th century English and Hebrew, Jewish studies, and cultural history at City College. Dr. Glenn Berger is an international expert in medieval English literature, medieval cultural studies, medieval gender and sexual studies, post-colonial theory, queer theory, and affect studies at Queens College. Dr. Herman Bennett is an internationally recognized expert in the history of the African diaspora, with a particular focus on Latin America at the Graduate Center. Dr. Helen Rosenblatt is an internationally recognized scholar of intellectual history, the French Revolution, the Enlightenment, and liberalism at the Graduate Center.
May I have a second for this item?
I second Angela Bivola.
Is there any discussion on items 5E through 5H? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. Those items are approved. Congratulations to each of the accomplished members of our faculty. We're proud to have you as part of our academic community.
Items number 5I through 5K are resolutions to award early tenure with an application of bylaw 6.2.C2 to the following individuals: Ivan Montiel at Baruch College, Andrew Jiang Zhu at Baruch College, and James Lowry at Queens College.
May I have a second for this item?
Second.
Is there any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. Those items are approved.
Item 5L is a resolution to award Jennifer Calder with immediate tenure at Lehman College with a waiver of bylaw 6.2.B.
Can I have a second for this item?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on this item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 5M is a resolution to name the Jack and Barbara Sobel Classroom and the Jack and Barbara Sobel Scholarship at Baruch College.
May I have a second for this item?
Kim, second.
So any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item 5N is a resolution to name the Arthur W. Weiss Room at Baruch College.
We have a second for this item.
Arvanites, second.
Any discussion on this item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item 5O is a resolution to name the Harlem Health Fellowship Award in Health Communications for Social Change at the CUNY Graduate School of Public Health and Health Policy.
May I have a second for this item?
I second the item.
Any discussion on the item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 5P is a resolution to name the Dr. Alan E. and Joan A. Dumont Endowed Scholarship at Hunter College.
May I have a second for this item?
Kim, second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 5Q is a resolution to approve naming opportunities in the DNA Learning Center at New York City College of Technology.
May I have a second for this item?
Second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 6 is the Committee on Facilities Planning and Management. Item number 6A is a resolution to request the City University Construction Fund to execute new requirements contracts for consulting services related to university capital projects. The City University Construction Fund issued a request for qualifications to solicit and award consulting contracts to replace 36 2015 engineering contracts and 30 2015 architectural contracts, which have expired, enabling the city's the university's ability to expand, improve, and renovate all university facilities. 189 requirements contracts will be awarded with a not-to-exceed amount of $4.95 million per contract and a term of 3 years plus a three-year option to renew.
May I have a second for this item?
Arvanites, second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item 6B is a resolution to request the City University Construction Fund execute new requirements contracts for real estate advisory services for the university real estate projects. The City University Construction Fund issued a new request for qualifications to solicit and award new real estate advisory consulting requirements contracts to replace expired 2014 contracts. Six requirements contracts will be awarded with a not to exceed amount of $4.95 million per contract and a term of 3 years plus a 2 year extension.
May I have a second for this item?
Arvanites, second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 6C is a resolution to authorize management by the City University Construction Fund for capital projects up to $10 million. In 2008, the Board of Trustees granted DASNY authority to enter into contracts for university capital projects up to $10 million. In 2018, the university's Board of Trustees granted authority for the university to enter into task orders for energy-related contracts for university capital projects up to $10 million under the master cost recovery agreements with NYPA, the New York Power Authority. University, through its facilities planning and construction department, and pursuant to contracts procured and entered into by the City University Construction Fund, desires to expand its project management capabilities to efficiently deliver on time and on budget university capital projects. For that purpose, the university now seeks parity among all university capital projects managed by DASNY, NYPA, and CUCF, and is requesting authority for CUCF to enter into contracts for university capital projects up to $10 million, confirming previous authority granted for NYPA-managed university capital projects up to $10 million, and confirming previous authority granted for DASNY-managed university capital projects up to $10 million.
May I have a second for this item?
4 seconds.
Any discussion on the item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 60 is a resolution to authorize a lease amendment to extend the term for lease at 30-20 Thompson Avenue, Queens, New York, for LaGuardia Community College. The university, on behalf of LaGuardia Community College, is seeking authority to execute a 10-year lease extension at substantially the same terms, except the annual base rent for year 6 to 10 of the extension term will increase from $41.70 per rentable square foot to $44.28 per rentable square foot. In lieu of operating expense escalations, the base annual rent will increase annually by 2.5%. The university will receive 6 months of free rent, and the landlord is providing $7,895,000 for certain capital improvements to be performed by the landlord. And the landlord is also funding the installation of a new HVAC system.
May I have a second for this item?
Leonardo Garcia, second.
Thank you. Any discussion on this item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 60 is a resolution to authorize a new lease agreement with Cypress Hills Local Development Corporation as landlord at 276 Chestnut Street, Brooklyn, New York, for Kingsborough Community College. Kingsborough will be establishing a satellite campus at the Chestnut Commons development as part of Kingsborough's efforts to reach its enrollment targets by providing students at this location with credit-bearing courses, certificate programs, remediation courses, placement and re-enrollment support, alignment of certificate programs with local employers in the job market, and other services. The first floor space will contain 2,200 rentable square feet and consist of two 40-person classrooms and an administrative office, as well as an IT closet for a term of 15 years, and an annual base rent of $60,500, which is $27.50 for rentable square feet, with 2% annual base rent increases in lieu of operating expense escalations, no real estate taxes, utilities included, and maintenance repairs being provided by the landlord.
You have a second for this item.
Berger, second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 6F is a resolution to authorize a 31-year leasehold condominium dormitory transaction at 569 Lexington Avenue, New York, New York, for Baruch College and Hunter College. The university strives to identify and provide affordable, quality housing options as part of its mission to provide an affordable quality education. The university is replacing 612 dormitory beds at various locations, currently having an annual liability in fiscal year 22 of $9,003,704.52, otherwise known as $1,564.74 of a blended monthly rate per bed. With 384 beds at the 569 Lexington Avenue building having an annual liability in fiscal year 23 of $4,377,600, otherwise known as a $1,200 monthly rate per bed, a 23.31% reduction and the monthly rate per bed. These significant savings are achieved through a leasehold condominium structure that allows the university to leverage its tax-exempt status for the benefit of its students. The Baruch Hunter replacement beds will provide affordable, below-market quality student housing within walking distance to both Baruch College and Hunter College, with price and location stability over the next 31 years, facilitating increased occupancy to generate sufficient revenue to cover the costs for the project.
May I have a second for this item?
Barrera seconds.
Is there any discussion on this item? Okay, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item number 7 is a resolution of appreciation for Vice Chancellor Brian Cohen.
May I have a second for this item?
I'll ask you a second.
Any discussion on the item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved in appreciation.
Item number 8 is a resolution to appoint Ann Rost as Interim Vice Chancellor for Technology and University Chief Information Officer, effective February 1, 2022, at a salary not to exceed $30,000 for a period of 2 months, and in accordance with the Board of Trustees approved guidelines on the reemployment of retired public employees.
We have a second for this item.
A second.
Any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved.
Item number 9 is a resolution to adopt a policy requiring campuses and the central office to eliminate the use of certain single-use plastic items.
We have a second for this item.
I'll ask you a second.
Is there any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item is approved.
Item number 10 is a resolution of appreciation for Interim Vice Chancellor for Advancement, Andrea Shapiro Davis.
May I have a second for this item?
Kim, second.
Second.
Arvanita,
I think we all want to second this item. All right, any discussion on the item?
I would like an opportunity both, of course, Brian and Andrea for the incredible work they have done for CUNY. And knowing that Andrea, her experience and being a CUNY graduate and her leadership that she has had in institutional advancement and support of women is quite recognizable. And just her energy and compassion that she has for CUNY. So just honored that I had the opportunity of working with her on initiatives for CUNY and really appreciate what she has done, which makes CUNY stronger. And now that she will be on her way to the mayor's office and continuing her opportunities for making the city of New York even stronger than what we have now. So wish her great opportunity here and wish her well. And Brian, of course, we didn't have an opportunity to talk about you and wish you well too.
Very well said, Trustee Wilkin. Very well said.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Just like to echo the sentiments from Trustee Wilkins. The resolutions for both Brian and Andrea speak to, in Brian's case, decades of service to the university and to New York City in previous roles. Andrea, a shorter time at the university, but also roles at CUNY in the city. in Andrea's case, CUNY blood running through it, through her as an alum. But I also want to highlight how during this particular difficult time of the pandemic, when we've all been asked to work harder, so many of the solutions that we have on a technological side, Brian was there day in, day out, making sure that we were ready for them. I want to thank him for that. And Andrea on her side, asking everybody she could for money, for the chancellor's funds and other to support our students. So these two great colleagues showed their very, very best during the most difficult time of the university, and forever we're thankful for them.
Well said, Chancellor. Thank you so much. Any other comments? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. And that item is approved. The Chancellor has asked the board to consider two additional resolutions. I'll ask the secretary to read each resolution for the record, and we will first vote to add the item and then take a vote on the item itself. Gail, could you please read the resolutions? You're muted.
Sorry, item number 11 is a mandate, is a resolution to mandate COVID-19 vaccinations for all faculty, instructional staff, and individuals subject to the executive compensation plan of the City University of New York in compliance with the New York State Governor Kathy Hochul's directive and mandate for a safe reopening of state higher educational institutions. Whereas there is no known cure for COVID-19, and it is a highly contagious, severe respiratory illness that could lead to death. And whereas in addition to a number of COVID-19 vaccines currently recognized by the World Health Organization to be effective against the spread of the COVID-19 virus, there are currently three known effective vaccines authorized for use by the United States Food and Drug Administration being administered to combat the spread of COVID-19 in the United States, which were manufactured respectively by the companies Moderna, Pfizer, and Johnson & Johnson. And whereas the Pfizer vaccine has been approved and licensed for general use for immunization against COVID-19 virus by the FDA, and whereas the COVID-19 vaccines have been proven to be effective in preventing the spread of COVID-19 in adults, and in the case of one COVID-19 vaccine in children over the age of 5 and have been approved by the FDA, and whereas the CDC has confirmed that individuals who are not vaccinated with a COVID-19 vaccine or at a significantly higher risk of contracting COVID-19, and such individuals could also put others at risk through the transmission of the virus. And whereas the university adopted policy 7.061, SARS-CoV-2 COVID-19, mandating that, quote, as requirement and condition for the admission and registration for fall 2021 in-person classes, that all such students receive a COVID-19 vaccine and that such mandate be effective on the latter of 1, the beginning of the 2021 fall term, or 2, when at least one of the COVID-19 vaccines is fully licensed by the FDA and available to anyone who wants it, subject only to legally required medical and religious exemptions and exceptions. And whereas during the last 8 months, notwithstanding the introduction of the Omicron variant, through the administering of COVID-19 vaccines throughout the City of New York and the State of New York, the number of infections, hospitalizations, and deaths has significantly decreased to the point that many of the public access and density restrictions are being relaxed or lifted throughout the State of New York. And whereas on January 1, 2022, New York State Governor Kathy Hochul announced that she was directing the Board of Trustees of the State University of New York and the City University of New York to mandate a vaccination policy for the faculty of the respective state higher educational institutions, subject only to legally required medical and religious exemptions and exceptions. And whereas the university has assessed the gubernatorial directive and mandate and has determined that it is in the best interest of the university to protect the university community, including its faculty, instructional staff, and individuals subject to its executive compensation plan or executive compensated personnel. And whereas the university has determined that compliance with the gubernatorial directive and mandate is integral to the continued operations of the university, and it shall use its best efforts in good faith to comply with the directive and mandate in a timely manner. And whereas, to ensure a continued safe return to campus classes, programs, and facilities, the University Board of Trustees has concluded that it is in the best interest to mandate the COVID-19 vaccination for all faculty, instructional staff, and personnel in the executive compensation plan, subject in all cases to medical and religious exemptions and proof of vaccination in accordance with the university's requirements for other required immunizations. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the University Board of Trustees hereby mandates as requirement to and condition of eligibility of employment for the City University of New York, subject in all cases to medical and religious exemptions and exceptions, all faculty, instructional staff, and personnel in the executive compensation plan must be fully vaccinated with a COVID-19 vaccine, and be it further resolved that the University Board of Trustees authorize the chancellor to make such additional changes and adjustments to said COVID-19 vaccine faculty mandate policy and take such actions as he deems necessary and appropriate to engage in impact negotiations with such affected employees as may be required in accordance with any contracts or agreements with such employees. And be it further resolved that in the implementation of said policy, the chancellor is further authorized to take into account and comply with any subsequent change in federal, state, and or municipal laws, regulations, and such relate to the as such relate to the COVID-19 virus and the related public health emergency, and that any and all such actions, changes, and adjustments to such COVID-19 faculty vaccine mandate policy taken by the chancellor in accordance with the foregoing resolutions be and they hereby approved and authorized without further action of the University Board of Trustees.
I make a motion to add item number 10 to our agenda. May I have a second for that?
Berger, second.
Item number 10 has been added. I now present item number 10. May I have a second for this item?
Berger, second.
Is there any discussion on this item?
Burke, discussion?
Yes.
Okay. Simply for the record, Chair Thompson, and for my colleagues across the university, might I ask the chancellor to explain to us briefly that as I heard the resolution so ably read by the secretary of the Board of Trustees, that the resolution is both mandating on the part of the board and then empowering the chancellor to engage in impact negotiations with the professional staff Congress. Am I correct in that summation?
Chancellor?
So there is both a mandate and empowering the chancellor to engage in conversations with the PSC for the faculty and the instructional staff.
Okay. Then Chancellor, is the mandate effective immediately or pending the outcome of the impact negotiations with the professional staff Congress?
It is pending a conversation. That needs to occur. I think the most important message is that we want everybody to be vaccinated and boosted, if eligible, as soon as we can, right? So now with the authority of the board, we can proceed to engage in those conversations.
Thank you.
To be even clearer, we are certainly not talking about a negotiation over a public health measure, are we? Chancellor? Anybody?
The conversation would be about the implications of the mandate and the implementation of the mandate, not about the need about the public policy response to a health crisis.
All right, fair enough.
Any other comments? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you like to abstain or oppose. That item's approved. Gail, item number 12. You're on mute.
Saving my voice. Item number 12 is a resolution to amend the standardized testing requirements for undergraduate admission. I will now read the entire resolution. This is whereas on July 30th, 2020, the Board of Trustees of the City University of New York approved the special COVID-19 temporary suspension of standardized testing requirements for undergraduate admission, which implemented a temporary suspension of standardized admissions testing requirements, i.e. or e.g. the SAT and ACT, for undergraduate admissions for the spring 2021, fall 2021, and spring 2022 admission cycles. And on March 24th, 2021, the Board of Trustees voted to extend that policy for the fall 2022 and spring 2023 admission cycles. And whereas these actions were intended to address the inability of many high school seniors to prepare for such admissions exams as a result of the disruptions caused by the COVID-19 public health emergency, and whereas these actions were aligned with the policy decisions of the majority of universities and colleges across the country to temporarily change their standardized testing practices for admissions by making the standardized SAT and ACT admissions tests optional or suspending their use. And whereas these actions were aligned with recommendations from the National Association for College Admissions Counseling, which urged institutions of higher education to reassess the use of the SAT and ACT admissions exams in light of the disruptive effects the COVID-19 public health emergency was having on graduating high school students and academic schedules. And whereas in response to these actions and to maintain the university's admission standards, the university's colleges developed and implemented enhanced admissions practices during the affected terms, including using more information from high school transcripts with a focus on performance in key subjects and expanding the use of student essays and letters of recommendation at our most selective colleges. And these more comprehensive practices were aligned with a large number of strategically selective peers. And whereas nearly 80% of bachelor's degree granting colleges do not require SAT scores for fall 2022 admissions, and many are now extending that suspension for two or more years further. And whereas the enhanced admissions process put in place during the suspension of requiring SAT or ACT scores has already shown promise as a better predictor of admitted student success without the use of those scores. And whereas broadening the factors used to determine admissions fitness allows our colleges to broaden access to a high quality education of value without diminishing standards, learning, or undergraduate outcomes, which amplifies our ability to serve our mission in sustainable ways. And whereas the university needs additional time to gather data on the success of students admitted while admissions exams are not required, and a permanent admissions policy will be most effective if based on more complete data on student progress to degree. And whereas providing prospective students the option to submit or not submit SAT or ACT scores will likely encourage more of them to apply to the university. And whereas the COVID-19 public health emergency continues and its resolution is highly unpredictable, now therefore be it resolved that effective immediately, the university will make the submission of standardized test scores, i.e. the SAT and ACT, optional for admission consideration for fall 2023, spring 2024, fall 2024, and spring 2025, and will communicate to prospective students that standardized admissions tests may be submitted as part of their applications, but that applicants will not be penalized for choosing not to submit standardized test scores. And be it further resolved that the chancellor shall take such actions as are reasonable and necessary to give effect to the foregoing while maintaining the university's commitment to inclusive excellence, high standards, and organizational sustainability. And be it further resolved that the University Office of Applied Research, Evaluation, and Data Analytics will continue to gather data on the progress of the cohorts of students admitted while the SAT and ACT are optional, and will report its findings annually to the chancellor. The explanation is as follows. This provisional optional test submission policy will allow the university to gather a full set of data on the efficacy of its enhanced admissions criteria in order to confirm their reliability in predicting student progress. Implementing a test optional admissions policy for an additional 2 years will allow the university to build on the advances our colleges have made in admissions practices since spring 2020, collect more data, and study the role of standardized tests in university admissions to inform future board policies on undergraduate admission.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to add item number 12 to our agenda. Do I have a second?
First. Angela Buell, I second.
Second.
Okay, the item has been added. I now present item number 12. May I have a second?
Rare seconds.
Any discussion on this item? All right, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. That item has been approved. With that, there being no further business, I'd like to ask for a motion to adjourn this meeting. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second.
All right, everyone take care, be safe. It's good seeing everybody. Our meeting is adjourned. Thank you all. All right.